Joining us in California is Emil Guillermo. He is the host of the PETA Podcast, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. He also is a renowned journalist who writes for the the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund. And you write about everything, but also Asian issues.
Yeah.
You have a problem with Amorosa.
Well, I don't really have a problem with Amorosa, but I noticed that her book is out and we should dismiss most of it because she's a liar. But she worked for a liar and we haven't dismissed him. So you got to at least sort of pay a little bit of an attention to her book because it's entertaining. But apparently she says some disparaging things about she says that Trump said disparaging things about Kellyanne Conway's husband, who happens to be Filipino-American. And so the Filipino-American community is sort of a buzz about that, because believe it or not, among Asian Americans who are mostly Democrats, the Asian Americans who support Trump are mostly Filipino, which is one of the odd things about the
Sense of humor.
Well, I think so. Yeah, from colonialism on. And I just, you know, this guy, George Conway is Kellyanne Conway's husband's name. Very religious. He's been very, very outspoken. And this is odd. Very outspoken against Trump when Trump tries to do, you know, in the first 16
months.
I've noticed.
Yeah. I thought it was marital problems, because I've noticed that a lot of his tweets are very critical, not only of Trump, but his wife. But then again, why would anybody who's married to Kellyanne not want to hurt her?
Well, I don't know. She always seems to compartmentalize her office life from her family life. Mm-hmm. She's a good Catholic girl and all that. And, you know, which stands to reason, Filipinos generally are good Catholics. I just found it odd that in the Filipino press, in the Philippines, they're talking about Kellyanne Conway's husband being dissed by Trump, sourced, of course, by Omarosa's book. So maybe they'll sell a few copies in the Philippines.
So she claims in the book that Trump made disparaging comments about Filipinos or about George Conway.
And George Conway, she stretched it out to Filipinos and in general. And so.
But why wouldn't he? Why wouldn't he?
What, make disparaging remarks about Conway?
And Filipinos. That's his job. Well,
the Filipinos are, well, at least for the Filipinos who served in the White House, there are at least two critical ones who served under Bill Clinton. We know that, you know, the guy who gave cigars to Monica Lewinsky was a Filipino steward, by Yanni Nelvis. And when the Star Report thought they had something, you know, with Nelvis, like maybe he saw them together. But he said, no, I only gave her the presidential cigar. I didn't like actually see them do it. But he had his 15 minutes of fame. But Filipinos actually have served in the White House as stewards for a long time, because they come in through the Navy, they work their way up as ensigns, and they find themselves as stewards at the White House, essentially the White House pantryman. And so Conway, being a lawyer and also a Harvard-educated lawyer, mind you, is really a step up, but a very principled conservative. So there was Trump taking shots at him whenever, Trump was making some kind of claims about the Supreme Court or about legal maneuvers. Conway was quick to criticize. And then Kellyanne was quick to not rock the boat. And here's Omarosa rocking everything that she can because she's trying to sell books. So
why is she not believed on our side?
I think because she has a record of not being believed. She blows with the wind, as they say. Maybe that's a poor choice of phrase, but she, where is the truth with Omarosa?
Do you think she was fired in the Situation Room? Do you think those tapes are real? Because if General Kelly, the chief of staff brought her into the Situation Room to fire her. She is a force of nature. Maybe he needed the entire U.S. military behind him. Maybe this was tougher than killing Osama bin Laden. Maybe. Why was she in the Situation Room? That's scandalous. Do you believe that?
Well, she claims that she has tapes, right? And so if she has tapes, that should be alarming in and of itself, because how does anyone get in there and tape, you know, this private conversation with the chief of staff? I just think that this is emblematic of just how low we've sunk as a government, as a democracy, when our White House doesn't even take, you know, this idea of governance seriously, the idea of national security seriously.
When I read about Moroso over the weekend, people were saying she may have violated rules by bringing recording equipment into the Situation Room. And I remember thinking, first of all, what is she doing in the Situation Room? And why didn't they spot the recording equipment? So
maybe she had it hidden in her bosom.
Oh, come on. They're blaming her, and you should be blaming Kelly and the White House staff for that.
Well, I certainly blame Kelly. I certainly blame Trump for the environment that we had. You know, this whole thing about
if she's a liar, why didn't she say, yes, I heard Donald Trump use the N-word? She said she knows that there's tape. She's heard the tape, but she herself never heard him use the N-word.
Well, that's a thing. How can you trust her?
How can you trust anybody in that White House?
Well, that's sort of the point, you know. I trust Michael Wolff because he was in there for a few weeks and he got the hell out.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So you're saying that the Filipinos should lose faith in Trump now? Or not?
Well, I'm saying that the largest group among Asian Americans to support Trump are the Filipino Americans. I don't know how that is. There's a lot of immigrants, you know, from the Philippines who are professionals who've come here post 1980, and they are professionals and they're wealthy, and generally speaking, and they like a strong, you know, capitalist like Trump. I mean, they back him, and also they have an inordinate hate for Hillary, a lot of those post-80s Filipino immigrants. So I think this may be a way to change some of them over to a more broadened sense of, like, what is the best for America? Because I think this this experiment of running our country like a government is just an absolute failure.
Running our country like a government.
Oh, excuse me. Running our government like a business is an absolute failure. Sorry about that. I misspoke. Like, as Trump does often.
Yes. Okay. Bleeding. There are bleeding mills, and you talk about them on the PETA podcast, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. What is a bleeding mill?
Well, that's my term for it. It's not really a bleeding mill. They suck the blood and the fluid from the abdomens of animals in these mills.
What kind of animals?
To pull out rats and mice and cows and pigs and rabbits. And they pull out the antibodies. They separate, they get the antibodies, and then they sell these antibodies, these mills, to institutions like the National Cancer Institute, federal, you know, governmental institutions. And the crazy thing about this is that animals are abused in the process, and they go through several cycles of this, getting the antibodies out. And the crazy thing is that there are non-animal testing methods that can be used, and they should be used. And if people are outraged by just this practice, and it's widespread, there was a news story of a company in San Diego that was just busted this past week, or excuse me, exposed, a company called ProSci. They do this sort of thing, and they've been cited 39 times for violations just in labs because, you know, they don't care about the animals. They just, you know, suck the antibodies out from there, suck this fluid and out of their abdomens, and then they create these antibodies. They sell them, and they don't really care about the animals, just enough to keep them alive, right? And that's why it's a kind of mill process. And if people are concerned, they should go to PETA.org and take action, send a note to the National Cancer Institute and tell them that, hey, there are non-animal testing methods that should be used. People can also text the word research to 73822. Research to 73822.
Is there any good that comes from these experiments?
Well, good is a relative term. I mean, yeah, there's good maybe from the antibodies in terms of using these tests, but the animals who gave up their lives or put through this torturous process to give the antibodies, it's not good for them. So if there are alternatives available, then why not? Then why not use those alternatives instead of having all these mills around the country, you know, doing this to animals and then selling this for top dollar to government agencies, to medical research firms, to places like the National Cancer Institute. And I just think that if you look at how the animals suffer, then clearly it's important to find important to use the alternative, and there is an alternative. So research, text research at 73822 to take action, or go to PETA.org.
I want to ask you about the Harvard Lampoon. You were on the Harvard Lampoon, but you went on and did something important with your life and became a journalist who many of you...
Well,
yeah.
I don't know. You know, David, I was right there at the time when there was only one guy who had gone on to great things in television comedy, and that would be Jim Downey, who was the producer for a long time under Lorne Michaels at Saturday Night Live. He was the first to do that, and I remember standing at the Lampoon Castle saying, "What are you going to do, Jim?" He says, "I'm going to make TV," and he did.
Hang on for 1 second. Mike Reese, this is the lore. The lore, according to Mike Reese, is that James Downey was the first guy from Harvard to make it in television. But what about the National Lampoon, Doug Kenny?
Well, they were all.
What about Caddyshack? What about Animal House and Caddyshack?
They were all Lampoon members, but Henry Beard, Doug Kenny, they went off and they didn't go straight into TV. They started the National Lampoon with Maddie Simmons. And that was their own franchise. And if it weren't for the National Lampoon, the Harvard Lampoon would be flat broke, or at least in those early years. And so, yeah, I'm not denying the genius of Doug Kenny. Absolute genius. Same with Henry Beard. Same with, there was another guy in that group who was more of the business mind, Rob Hoffman. But they were the kind of, with Maddie Simmons, they formed the National Lampoon, yeah. They were the first to make it in major media. And, of course, they did it with the Cosmopolitan. They had this parody. They parodied magazines. This is like prehistoric times. Like if the Lampoon was around in prehistoric times, they would be parodying cave drawings, you know. Mm-hmm. That's not like we're talking about it in almost in that sense. Because every year or every decade, every few decades, as the media changes, the Lampoon changed. And when things went to TV, that was Downey's year. Downey was 73, 70. He graduated 75. After Downey, Conan O'Brien was up there. Mike Reese came up soon after. And then you can see where the evolution went from Saturday Night Live to the talk shows.
You were tapped your freshman, junior, sophomore year for the Lampoon?
I made it freshman year. I was.
That's unusual, isn't it?
Well, I mean, you know, it's like becoming, you know, your first year. You're like going to be 4 years there. You're going to be among the leadership, right? It's a really unique thing. And I admit, I wasn't necessarily a writer. I was known for my witty repartee at the cocktail parties and selling condom ads and ads to abortion clinics in Boston and putting them in the Lampoon. I was kind of on the business side, and because frankly I got to the magazine and, you know, I come from an ethnic background in San Francisco, and the humor at the time was very elitist. You know, when the motto of the Lampoon on some of their T-shirts said heritage and breeding, and here's this Filipino guy coming around. I mean, that was kind of funny, but it was also kind of, you know, in terms of my sense of self and my identity, it wasn't the kind of humor that I was used to, where I was the punchline. And so,
the Lampoon taught a generation of comedians to punch down, which was very handy during the Reagan years.
Yeah, you know, look, that whole idea of punching down, the whole idea of using Negro as a punchline. Look, I think I was like the first Filipino to be on the Lampoon. There was like one black guy before me. There was a bunch of Asians who came after me because they were good at illustration. Later on, there were some funny Asian guys too, as well as funny, you know, comic artists. But I remember being there my first year thinking like, God, I'm like an accessory here. I'm not related.
But you must have been funny. What did you have to write something to be approved?
I had to be a part of the group. And so, like I said, I sold condom ads for the magazine. I was funny at the cocktail parties. People recognized me as a funny guy. And I kind of shut up mostly in terms of my literary aspirations. I did have literary aspirations, but the Lampoon, it was too raw to expose it there. And part of my one-man show that I'm bringing to San Francisco.
And you delivered the funny speech at Harvard graduation. What is that?
Yeah. Well, this is why Mike knows me, because he knows, who gave the Ivy Oration the Ivy Oration is the class day speech given by essentially the class clown. You're the guy that the class has picked, that you get voted by a committee. You know, you compete against all these people, generally the high officers of the Lampoon, who are delivering these speeches about Harvard. And I won that year. And as the Harvard Crimson quoted me, I am flabbergasted that, you know, that I made it. But it was, it sets up the stage for the one-man show that I finally am doing now, some 40 years later or so, about that experience. And I talk about that.
Is it positive or negative?
I make fun of Harvard, and I'm sort of like reverse Andy Kaufman. I become, if Andy Kaufman were Filipino, that's the kind of speech I give. And most people were just absolutely stunned. You know, what the hell's going on? Mm-hmm. Is this the international graduation? Are we in the right place?
Right.
Is it? And then, when I let it out, I got the biggest laugh I ever got in my life. Maybe the laugh of all time that I could live on. And in fact, I have lived off that laugh for the last 40 years until, you know, now I have to go out and seek a few more. But it was such a huge laugh that it affected me. It affected me. And and I also didn't want to go into comedy or the humor game. I went to news, and the rest is sort of my one-man show that I talk about. I mean, I talk about this experience a lot because it meant a lot. And you know, the time I've seen Mike, we met Mike Reese a number of times at alumni events, and he always talks about, you're Emil, the missing Lampoon guy, because, you know, all the guys who gave the Ivy all went on to great careers in comedy, like Downey and I think Conan O'Brien gave the Ivy his year. And this is a speech at 2004. Sacha Baron Cohen was the main speaker. You know, they bring in these the outsiders to come in and give speeches along with the guy who gives the Ivy. And so my year, George Plimpton, who was a Lampoon guy, you know, gave the speech. And so a very touching exchange in my one-man show, after my speech, that Plimpton and I had. So anyway,
he was supportive.
He was sort of, but kind of not really. But that's why you have to see my one-man show, Amok Monologues, coming to San Francisco August 17th. Go to amok.com for tickets.
Was he condescending and dismissive?
Well, he is taller than me, so it's not, it's hard not to be condescending somehow physically, you know.
Yeah.
But look, I respect my elders as a good Asian. It was just an interesting time, the Lampoon, and I've had a love hate kind of relationship with the Lampoon, ever since those days. I mean, here's the thing about Harvard: you just can't go to Harvard and forget about it. Most people do. I mean, God, if you're still talking about Harvard 40 years after, boy, it must have done a number on you. Or are you, because you should be bigger. You should be like Jared Kushner. Does he ever talk about Harvard? How his father paid $2 million to get him in? Does he ever say, "Oh yeah, my Harvard days"? There, that's how come that's how I got the New York Observer. Does he ever talk about that? No.
You said something that really resonates with me. You said you have a love-hate relationship with Harvard, and Trump is destroying all our institutions.
Yeah,
he's a wrecking ball. Mm-hmm. It's uncomfortable for people like me to say, whoa, wait a second. We have to respect the FBI and the CIA, and these institutions are important. And then I realized when you just said I have a love-hate relationship with Harvard, that's what America is. We have a love-hate, or at least we should have a love-hate relationship with our institutions. This blind reverence that people have for the police is sick.
Yeah. Oh, believe me. Look.
And so we need to return to this love-hate relationship with all our institutions, including New York City. I said earlier in the show, all the problems in America can be traced back to that time in the 1980s when it stopped being cool to crap on New York City. Yeah. We have to crap on New York City and San Francisco and Harvard and our government, and at the same time, love them.
I agree with you, because how do you think I felt, the son of a Filipino immigrant who was, in fact, a colonized American? My father was born in the Philippines 8 years after the Treaty of Paris as a colonized American in the Philippines. And, the idea of William Taft, the American governor, sitting on a Philippine water buffalo.
Shouldn't the water buffalo been sitting on William Howard Taft?
Yeah. Well, yeah. Reverse that a bit. The William Howard Taft with his handlebar mustache sitting on a water buffalo with its large, long horns. And it's an image you can look up. But that's the colonial image, right? The white man, and of course Taft, Harvard, Teddy Roosevelt in the Spanish-American War, Harvard, and here I come, a few years after, so all the major civil rights laws are passed, coming into Harvard and thinking that this is the institution that's mine, right? I'm a part of this institution, and to find out that I'm not really part of it. Not really.
Well, the solution is break up big Harvard. Why does every Supreme Court justice come from Harvard and Yale? I was watching RBG, the documentary about Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Mm-hmm. She graduated from Columbia Law, and I thought, there's an outlier, a variant. It turns out she spent the first 2 years at Harvard Law. So we need to break up big Harvard, big Yale, big Princeton.
Look, I'm with you. Harvard, Roberts actually was at Harvard when I was there, which is sort of a sad thought that a person of my generation can. Well, is he the swing vote? They're saying he might be the swing guy, the swing conservative. Once the court gets realigned, maybe he won't be as conservative as he is now, but. He was there at the same time. I'm just saying that to connect with your idea that, break up big Harvard. We give too much. There's too much reverence given to Harvard. And I know I've used in the last 30, 40 years, I've often used Harvard as this weapon, right? To say, here, I'm going to smote you down with my Harvard sword here. And because people cower to that generally.
Mm-hmm.
And they shouldn't, they should just take people for who they are and what they do and forget about the Harvard credential.
But never forget about Emil Guillermo. You can see his one-man show.
August 17th at Manila Town, 868 Kearney Street. For tickets, go to amok.com.
And go to the PETA Podcast, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. Stay on the line, sir. Stay on the line.
Yes, yes.